grateful we are. Grateful that you are who you are. Grateful that you kept us. Grateful, Lord, that you helped us walk through the valley. Grateful that you'll never leave us. Or forsake us, you'll never give us more than we can bear, even when it feels like it. We're grateful. Lord, as I stand before your wonderful people, please allow, sir, the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, for you are my strength and you are. In the name of Jesus, I pray that the church say amen.
Amen.
Come with us now to the Old Testament, Psalm number 8. Psalm number 8. Our emphasis will be verses 1 and 2. And won't you stand out of reverence for God's holy word? And listen now for the word of the Lord. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouths of babes and infants, you have founded a bulwark because of your foes to silence the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of them, mortals that you care for them? Yet you have made them a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You have given them dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under their feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. Oh, Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. As always, look at someone and smile at them this morning. Tell somebody. Say somebody.
Somebody.
Oh, he's somebody.
Somebody.
Say, it's time.
It's time.
To praise God.
To praise God.
Oh, glory to God. Welcome to a new year, my beloved.
Thank you.
We made it. Tell your neighbor, say, we made it.
Yeah.
At the beginning of each new year, there is an opportunity for us to re-examine and to rediscover and to re-evaluate, look and determine what we need to be doing this year. That's why we make New Year's resolutions, because we know that there are things in our lives and in our churches that need to be tweaked, that we need to make a commitment to, and that we need to focus on. And so we're going to name something today and claim it as our resolution to be doing in 2017. Beloved, you know, it's all the craziness. It's some crazy things going on in the world today. They're just crazy. The devil is running rampant, not just in the world, but also in the church. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Doubts and fears in our world today. We need to understand something, child of God. We need to understand something wonderful needs to be happening in the church of Jesus Christ this year. People are looking at the church to do what the world is not even supposed to do what the government can't do, to do what we can't do without God. The world today needs the church of Jesus Christ. The world needs to witness a renewed energy in the church. Oh, we're getting there, Pacoima First. We're getting there. Because I truly believe that this year God is going to restore everything the enemy not only stole from you, but from the church.
Yes.
And the devil has stolen a lot of things from the church of Jesus Christ. Sometimes we get surprised at how the church acts, but what we need to understand is that in this day and time, the devil is attacking the church like never before. It would be his greatest coup to destroy God's church. The devil walked right up into church, took away our compassion for each other, our love for each other. He ran right up in here and took away our desire to know God, love God, and wait on God. And instead, he put our attention on ourselves. We live in a society where, gee, we just obsessed with ourselves. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Sometimes I say, God, can you just stop me from worrying and thinking about my situation? Can you just stop me every time I can't sleep at night? I'm acting crazy. You know what I mean? It's just, I look at the world and it's just me, me, me. And then he tells us to focus on people instead of God. And I am convinced that the reason so much is happening is that God wants our attention. We have put our faith in people and in things, even in our family, only to be disappointed. Because you know what? People are people. You can't put your faith in people. They love you today and don't like you tomorrow. You know, their feelings are transitory. They come and they go. You talk to the next minute, you're at the bottom. People in your own family. It ain't other folks stealing your stuff, boo. You know what I'm thinking? I don't tell it on nobody, but you know, you better watch your cousins. I'm telling you. Jesus, help me up here. Don't talk about Uncle Nobody. Don't talk about him. But our focus should be, in 2017, our focus should be on God, because God says, shall not prevail against it. The only thing we can depend on in 2017 is God and his church. The best child of God, there's one reality that I want us to deal with today, and that reality is that of all the things the enemy took from the church, the most detrimental thing was what we are going to talk about this morning. The enemy, the devil, took one of the church's most valuable treasures, namely our praise. Ooh. The devil stole praise from the church. I remember growing up when we used to talk about people who praise God. Somebody say amen, because I grew up in a little United Methodist Church where if you said amen, they would ask you if you needed something. The people were real, you know, sophisticated. So sophisticated they ain't gonna get to heaven, because you can't get to heaven being sophisticated. God ain't impressed with sophistication. Oh, help me up in here, somebody. And so our job as a church is to regain what the enemy has taken. And I'm gonna talk today. I decree in the name of Jesus that in 2017, we're going into the enemy's camp and we are going to take back what the devil stole from the church. Tell your neighbor, it's time to take back our praise.
It's time to take back our praise.
In our scripture lesson for this day, the word says, and let us start with verse 2a. It says, from the lips of children and infants, you have ordained praise. In other words, so manifest are God's perfections and so powerful is praise that by very weak instruments, God can set forth his praise. Have you ever watched a baby sleeping and suddenly, you know, while they sleep, they smile in their sleep? And, you know, the old folks would say, they were right about so much, say that the baby was talking to the angel. Well, you know what the angels do. The angels are always praising God. And have you seen the glee and the excitement in children when they are presented with the stars at night and the moon and the heavens, the ocean, a flower, a bug, a bird? Praise is so strong and powerful that even the weak little baby's praise will stop the work of the enemy. We should learn from a child, because we too must realize that God gives us the very breath we breathe. God gives us the beats in our heart. God upholds our strength. God heals our bodies and minds and emotions. God saves. God provides.
Yes.
And God defeats the enemy for his glory.
Amen.
You want to show your class, boo? Your education, your upbringing? Then do what's appropriate in the church. It is church etiquette and church protocol to praise the Lord.
Amen.
I remember in Dallas when I was with my mentor, Pastor Dr. St. Holmes Jr., when he told us that we were going to stop acting like we acted. And that we were going to go back to the authentic black church tradition. And he wanted us to go to some of the other churches. The black church has always held on to its Pentecostal tradition, its love for spiritual things that we brought from Africa. You know, we were the strongest and the best that Africa had. And so we came with all of that spirit. We couldn't have made it through without the Holy Ghost. And so he was telling us, he said, now look, I want you who are gonna be preachers to learn how to worship. And so I want you to go to some of the black churches and sit there and watch how they worship, because you are going to be the ones to show the congregation where we are going. And I want you to say amen, and I want you to clap your hands, and I want you to be involved in the worship service. And there I was. I wasn't there yet. I said, the best I can say is wonderful. You know, God will take you from where you were. Oh, glory to God. I still say that I will always be grateful to Dr. Zan Holmes for bringing me home, for bringing me to God, for showing me and allowing me to learn to worship the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings without apology or shame. It's just good etiquette.
Amen.
the Lord. And you know, one of the things we ask, we think that praise comes naturally, but really, praise doesn't come naturally. Praise is something that is learned. Say, it's learned. Look at children, look at children. You have to teach them to say thank you. You know, they know how to say gimme. They know how to say no. Well, when somebody says, you're such a pretty little girl, what do you say? That's what you ask them. What do you say? Because they're ready to go on to the next thing. Thank you ain't in their vocabulary. So we're always teaching them to be grateful. What do you say? Thank you. That's what we're going to learn. I'm going to say, what do you say? It's a learned thing. So the question this morning is, what is praise? Praise in its essence is adoration of God for the things that he's done for you and for me. For a workable definition, however, you must qualify this by going further and explaining what praise looks like. Tell your neighbor, say, you can see it.
Yes, you can see it.
Listen to me. Praise is always active, assertive, demonstrative, and open. When people say, you know, the church is just putting on a performance, they just so dramatic, there's nobody in more dramatic than God himself. We can say, let's have be light. Is that drama or what? That's drama. The world took from what the church ought to have. It's not passive and presumptuous and undemonstrative or secretive, whatever. Praise is, it's open and active. Whenever praise is mentioned in the Bible, there is movement and action, sounds and songs seen and heard. In the church, we ought to say, let's look further. What do we learn from the word of God about praise? We learn many things, beloved. We learn that praise may be vocal. It says, my mouth will speak in praise of the Lord. Now, if we had a mouth that would talk more about God than we do each other, then the world would be a better place. Today. We just say stuff. We say stuff to hurt people. But when we focus on God, we teach our lips to say wonderful things of praise to God. And you ought to be saying it to the people around you. When they get on your nerves, say, praise the Lord. You know what would people do if they're trying to mess with you and you look at them and say, praise the Lord. Your way. What in the world would they do? You know the people sitting next to you on your job? You know the people? People who ain't saved. In the book of Deuteronomy chapter 27, it's in the Bible that after the preacher speaks the truth, it says, then the people would say, amen. Don't act like I'm the only one to know the truth. If you hear me speak the truth, say, praise is vocal. It's vocal adoration and it is response. Look at your neighbor and say, you got that? Amen. And praise may be audible without being vocal. Clapping is audible. Clap your hands, all you nations. Praise him with the tambourine and dancing. Praise him with the strings and flute. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Oh, somebody ought to show me. Clap your hands. In just a year and a half, God is working miracles up in here. Yeah. And there are forms of praise that are neither vocal or audible. One is the lifting of hands in your name. I will lift up. My hands declare the psalms. Another form of praise is neither vocal or audible. It's dancing. say this all the time, especially to my generation, because you know we try to be all that in a bag of chips, but I remember when my generation put the pen part. Someone don't get up in here and act like you can't dance. It's good for you anyway. Come on. Hey, just change your dancing partner. Yet another form of praise is visible. Not audible or vocal. It's that of kneeling. Kneeling. Therefore, in summary, praise is the adoration of God and thanks to God that is vocal, audible, or visible. Any one or all three of these. To bring it home, when you praise and adore God, you have to do something with your body. Yeah. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Because words alone can't tell God how good he is.
Yeah.
When my words can't express it, then I gotta use my body to say it. Because God understands body language.
Yeah.
We must learn from our children how to let go and let God.
Yeah.
When it comes to praise. Now, you don't have to be as demonstrative as some of us. I love to worship, and I'm not ashamed. I don't care y'all talk about me. I don't care. I love to worship. Once you taste it, see, once you taste it, you'll never go back. Once you taste it, praise. So when I go to church, I don't care what y'all looking at, what you're thinking, because I didn't even come here with you on my mind. I came to worship the Lord and the King of Kings, and I love to worship Him. Hallelujah, God, I love you, God. Well, don't tell me to be quiet. You just can't help yourself. So secondly, beloved, you need to understand that there is only one reason why people do not praise, and that is because they don't know who God is, truly. The absence of praise simply means that someone has an inadequate view of God. You see, that's why we praise people, and then we get in church and act like we dead. But we love people. So, you know, we praise football and we praise actors and actresses. And we praise things that don't deserve our praise. Because while you praising the football and the basketball people, you have to remember, beloved, they don't even know your name. When you need food on the table, they don't even know your name. If you naked, they don't give you nothing to wear. And they don't even know where you live. I heard somebody say, you know, Methodist folk, that's not Methodist. What they meant was, that's not white, but anyway.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's what they meant. But worship is authentically cultural. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
That's why people say Sunday morning is most segregated. Well, part of it is that it's cultural segregation. If you ain't gonna be worshiping like I worship in the authentic black tradition, I don't wanna come to your church and waste my time. You go to your cultural kind of worship. You like to be quiet and all like that, then fine, you do that. But I will tell you what, growing churches of all colors are becoming Pentecostal, because it's a Pentecostal time, and this gift that we have, everybody wants it now. Get an adequate view of God so that we can praise Him. in your own way, praise him. Some of y'all might be doing this. I might not even see you, but it's something moving, you know what I mean? Some of you just may shed some tears. That's fine. Some of y'all might do like this. Some of y'all might, you know. But whatever you do, it ain't got to be loud like me, because I'm just a loud person. But it don't help to have a little company up in here, too. You know what I mean? At least let me know you alive. We read, oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Therefore, the names of God stand for his manifold nature. His names are simply extensions of who God is. The names of God are how he reveals himself to us, how he tells us who he is, because names are important. That's why when you call somebody out of their name, they really fight. Because name calling is serious business. You a Christian, but somebody calls you out your name. You might just start acting like the name they called you. That's all I gotta say. I hate it when people tell me, but you a Christian. Yeah, I am a Christian, but don't push me too far. We slip sometime too. Therefore, the names of God stand for his manifold nature. His names are simply extensions. The names of God, how to reveal who God is. That's what we do. You are a Christian. And you should know God for yourself. We should know the names that tell us of God's character. So here we go. Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You want to know who God is? Look at God's names. In the Bible, we find the names of God. Elohim. He is the creator of heaven and earth, who was in the beginning. El Shaddai. He is the God Almighty of blessings. He is all bountiful and all sufficient. Adonai means he's our Lord and our Master. Jehovah. He is completely self-existent. One always present, revealed in Jesus. Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Yes. Jehovah Rapha, my healer. Yes. By his stripes, I am healed. Jehovah Yom Kadishi is the Lord, sanctifier. He has set us apart just for himself. Amen. And our standard, Jehovah Nisi. His banner over us is love. When the enemy shall come in like a flood, he'll lift up a standard against him. No weapon formed against us will prosper. Come on, devil, you can mess with me for a while. You know, don't forget Job. Don't forget Job. The Lord said, I don't know any more righteous man than Job. And one of the reasons the devil messes with you is that you anointed. Oh, Jesus. Oh, it ain't got nothing to do with you doing something bad. It ain't got everything to do with you being righteous. Oh, glory to God. Oh, Lord, our Lord. How majestic is your name. You have set your glory above the heavens. Oh, my dear child of God. You will praise God when you realize who God is. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So praise God, know God, and then understand. And finally, in verse 2 and B, settles it for us this morning. Some of you have been through some stuff in 2016. Just look at your neighbor and say, that's life. Ordained praise. Why, God, did you ordain praise? Well, the Bible says, because of our enemies' hope to silence the foe and the avenger. Oh, listen to me. Praise gets rid of your enemies and shuts the mouth of the devil. Mouth. Enemies like sickness and pain and sorrow and fear, depression and fatigue. Praise is our arsenal. Yes. Praise is our chief weapon against the enemy. The truth is that praise is strength and strength is praise. Praise stops the enemy dead in his tracks. Yeah. Neither the devil nor his demons can offer any protest after praise. They are hushed. When you praise God, the enemy panics. When you praise God, the enemy is devastated. When you praise God, the enemy is irritated. And I believe that demons turn on each other. Oh, Jesus.
Amen.
When we praise God, their ranks are broken. Your praises are like scratching on a blackboard or rubbing on a balloon. Praise makes the demon's flesh crawl. Their ears can't stand praise. Praise drives them crazy. Praise shuts their mouth and stops their plans. Somebody say, praise God today.
Praise God today.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Child of God, you need to praise the Lord in 2017. Even if you're already a praiser, become even more a praiser.
Amen.
When you are down and out, praise God.
Yes.
When everything that could go wrong goes wrong, praise God.
Yes.
When you're about to give up on a particular situation, just stop for a minute and praise God. When you're lonely, when death comes, when you're misunderstood, praise God. When you're sick, praise Him. When you're hurt, praise Him. Oh, let your praise take you somewhere. Don't linger in a bad reality. Praise will take you somewhere. This world is fake anyway. This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. Because I've heard of a city called heaven. And heaven is where I want to be home. The heavenly and the eternal scene. You can see God sitting high and looking low. Look up to the hills. From whence comes your help, beloved? Real praise will take you to a new reality. It will change the atmosphere.
Yeah.
Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm going to praise God.
Neighbor, I'm going to praise God.
I'm going to praise God.
Yeah.
In 2017, like I've never praised Him before. Okay. We're going to do something.
Oh,
goodness.
Come on. Yes, come on.
Don't get caught up in this world.
Yes. Yes.
Don't get caught up in the news of today.
Right.
Don't get caught up in what people are talking about.
Yes.
Learn to go to another place. We want to be spiritual, not religious. Spiritual, Lord, I will lift mine eyes to the hills.